Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Where did all that come from? Somebody must be playing tricks on me. I don't talk like that. I don't talk dog language or sheep language or bird language. I speak human language. Humphrey, what about you? What do you speak? Yes, you speak monkey language, don't you? Probably some other monkey might understand you, too. We say that monkeys communicate. That is, they're able to let another animal know what they mean by making sounds and by the things that they do. But he doesn't let someone else know what he wants by talking in words the way you do. He can't. He can let me know that what he wants is food, but he can't say in words, "I like bananas, and I'll eat what you give me. But honestly, teacher, I really would rather try a banana split for a change." I'd faint if he said that. Just making sounds is not what we call talking, is it? By talking, what we mean are those thousands of special sounds that we humans make called words. Do you think that any other animals talk in words the way we do? A parrot? Well, not really. A trained parrot can repeat the sounds that he hears others say. You can repeat words, too. But you can go a million miles beyond that when you talk. You can talk about the future and the past and about things you can't even see or touch. You can talk about when George Washington was the first president of the United States. And you can talk about someday when men might go to Mars. And you can talk about how you feel and how you think. No other animal can do that. Why not? Let's see if we can find out. How do you talk? What do you talk with? Yes, you talk with your mouth and your tongue and your lips. And where does the sound come from? Do this. That's right, it comes from your voice box or your larynx. So, you talk with your voice box, and where do the ideas that make you want to talk come from? Right from your brain. So you talk with your voice box and your brain. Well, it's the same thing with monkeys and baboons and chimps. Then why can't they learn to talk the way you do? They can't learn to talk the way you do because their brains are not like yours. They don't have the same nerve network in their brain that you have in yours. Their brain isn't as complicated as yours. It's the nerve network in your brain and the way it's put together that makes speech possible. That's why you can talk. And that's why human animals are sometimes called the talking animal. But do you think that human animals have always been able to talk? Do you think they've always been able to communicate in words the way we do now? Well, probably they've always been able to communicate in sounds the way other animals do. But nobody knows for sure just when people first began to talk in words. scientists say it took a long, long time for the human animal to invent a language so that he could share thoughts and ideas with other humans. There must have been many times in those long ago days when talking would have been helpful. After all, those were dangerous times. Suppose you were at home in a cave and an animal tried to get in. Well, your father would probably push you to the back of the cave and make noises that meant there's danger nearby. But he wouldn't be able to say, since he didn't have language, "Watch out, there's a bear trying to get in. Hide in the darkest corner up on the ledge while I try and scare him away." So, see? Being able to talk would have been helpful. And that's why early man invented language, because he needed it. If he hadn't invented language, we might all be living like cave people today. Now, there's something to think about. How about you? Have you always been able to talk so that everybody understood you? No, you haven't. Certainly not. Once, when you were brand new, all you did was cry. And that's what you did. Crying was the only way that you could let others know that you needed something. But later, when you were a little older, you began to make happy, bubbly, gurgly sounds. You watched and listened and made sounds for about a year. And then one day it happened. You said your first word. Maybe it was dada or ka or no. But whatever it was, everyone was so excited because you were beginning to talk. Do you know what your first word was? If you know it, say it for me now. Oh, good. Well, whatever your first word was, you soon began putting words together, like baby go ka or mama, give me cookie. Even at that early age, and with just a few words, you made sense. You made more sense than this. "'Twas brillig, and the slithy toves did gyre and gimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogroves, and the mome raths outgrabe." That's just part of a poem a famous writer once wrote for fun, all in silly talk. Do you talk silly talk sometimes? I thought so. But you don't do that all the time. Mostly you use sensible words, and you talk in sensible sentences. In fact, you talk, talk, talk. You do talk a lot, don't you? Everybody does. Try to imagine spending a whole day without talking. It wouldn't be easy, would it? And since everybody talks so much, why do they? Let's see. Do you talk because you need to ask questions? Yes, you do. Do you talk because you want to tell somebody what you want? Yes, you do that. To tell how you feel? Mm-hmm. To complain? To tell secrets? To make promises? Yes. You talk for all these reasons and for many more besides. Talking is the easiest, fastest, cheapest way of letting someone else know what you want them to know. Suppose I didn't talk to you. What would you think if I did this? Now, wouldn't that be weird? Weird, yes, and it would be a waste of your time and mine. How could you learn anything if I didn't try to explain things by talking? You wouldn't, would you? And since you talk so much, we must know a lot of words. I know you don't know as many words as are in my dictionary. There's about 100,000 words in here, and I certainly don't know them all. How many do you think you know? probably about 3,000. And you're learning more new words every day. That's a lot, 3,000 words. And just think, once you didn't even know any. Oh, what's that? Hello. Come in.
Hola, me llamo Jacqueline. Toqué en su puerta para saber si te gustaría comprar galletas de Grosca.
I'm sorry, I don't speak Spanish.
Oh, that's too bad. What I said was, my name is Jacqueline. I knocked on your door because I wanted to know if you wanted to buy some Girl Scout cookies.
Girl Scout cookies? I love them. Sure, I'd like to buy some. How do you say 2 boxes of cookies, please, in Spanish?
Dos cajas de galletas, por favor.
Ooh, dos cajas de galletas, por favor.
Right.
Thank you.
Gracias.
Ah, gracias. Adios?
Adios.
Oh, adios. Thank you. Now, isn't that interesting? There's someone who speaks more than one language. Jacqueline speaks both English and Spanish. Now, why do you suppose she speaks Spanish? Yes, because her parents spoke Spanish. And that's the sound and those are the words that she heard when she was a baby. If they spoke Chinese, she would have learned Chinese. And if your parents spoke Spanish, you'd know Spanish too. Whatever language people speak, all people talk. And not everyone speaks English. There are hundreds of languages spoken all over the world. Wherever you find people, you find language. Suppose you lived in Greece, and you wore a cap like this. When you said goodbye, you'd say, addio, and maybe blow a kiss. Or if you lived in France, and many Frenchmen do, you'd touch your cap like this, chérie, and say, bonsoir, adieu. Or if you were a Hollander, you'd really be in Dutch. If you forgot to bow and say, hivasti, and thank you very much. Suppose you had to wear a fez like this upon your head. And you forgot to say, alazim, aladik, and said, hello, instead. And now it's time for me to say goodbye for now to you. So, adio. Hivasti. And until next time, au revoir, adieu.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
This morning I found a little dead bird in my garden. Has that ever happened to you? I don't know what made him die, but I do know that wishing he would flap his wings and fly away again won't make it happen. He's in this box because my children suggested that we bury him in the garden. I think that's a fine idea. Knowing that living things are born, grow, and die makes me think and wonder about being alive. Do you think about that too sometimes? What keeps you alive anyway? Many things. You know what some of them are too. What's one thing that keeps you alive? Yes, breathing. It's absolutely necessary for you to breathe. Your cells have to have what? What is it that you breathe? Air. Yes, there's oxygen in the air that your cells must have in order to stay alive. And what part of your body do you breathe with? These? Your lungs? That's right. And how does the air get in and out of your lungs? That's right, through your nose and your mouth and your windpipe. All right, let's just take the lungs out and put them here. Now, what's something else you have to do besides breathing in order to stay alive? Eat and drink, of course. That's not hard to do. Your cells must also have food and water in order to stay alive. You can't just take a cookie and feed it to your cells somehow. Your cells want a cookie? No, that just won't work. First, your body has to get the food ready for your cells to use. And what parts of your body help get the food ready for your cells to use? Oh, yes, so many parts. I know. You help me name them. Where's the beginning?
Okay.
Yes, your teeth and your tongue help break the food up so that it's in smaller pieces and you can swallow it more easily. Then it can be pushed down and into your, do you remember this organ? Into your stomach, right. Your stomach churns the food around with some juices that it makes, and then it goes to your intestines, where some more juices are added until the food is so soupy that it can leak through the walls of your intestines and into your, do you remember, into your blood. Remember, it is your blood that carries the oxygen in the food and the water to all of your cells and to every one of your major organs. Like this one, the liver, for instance. Now, what's that important organ that helps you stay alive by keeping your blood moving? You point to it. Go ahead. Your heart, that's right. This amazing muscle, your heart, helps keep you alive by keeping your blood moving. It goes on pumping day and night without stopping. Your blood not only carries food and water and oxygen to all your cells, it also carries waste materials away from your cells. It carries carbon dioxide up to your lungs to be breathed out, and your blood carries liquid wastes down to your kidneys, so that it can be filtered out and sent on down to the bladder. Not all waste materials are carried by your blood, though. Some of them end up, let me show you, here at the end of your intestine. This waste is what's left from the food that couldn't be digested. But in any event, your body has to get rid of poisonous waste materials, whether it's carbon dioxide or solid or liquid waste, in order for you to stay alive. Look at these. Look. These are all important organs that keep you alive by the work that they do. Now suppose one of them wasn't working right, suppose it couldn't do its job, would you die? No, I don't think so. People can live with just one lung or one kidney or a damaged heart because doctors know how to use medicines and machines to keep them alive. Blind people, deaf people, people with arms and legs that don't work right can still enjoy living as long as their brain is alive. And that's the most important organ of all. None of your other body parts would work without it. Without your brain and its network of nerves and sense organs, you wouldn't be able to see or hear or smell or taste or feel anything. Without your brain, you wouldn't be able to move because it's your brain that tells your muscles when to move. Without your brain, you wouldn't be able to think. And if you couldn't think, you wouldn't know enough to do the things you have to do to keep your wonderful body machine alive and in good working condition. For instance, if you didn't think, you wouldn't eat the things your body needs. You know, the good foods that we talked about in the four foods groups. You wouldn't remember to brush your teeth so that they would last for a lifetime. You wouldn't think about washing your skin to keep it clean and pretty and free from germs. You might not remember to exercise every day to keep your muscles strong. You probably wouldn't care about getting enough rest or sleep so that the next day you'd be alert and happy. You wouldn't think about going to the doctor when you were sick or to go once a year for a checkup. And you wouldn't think about your safety and staying out of accidents. You might ride your bike right down the middle of a street full of cars. Now, wouldn't that be a brainless thing to do? I wonder, is that it? Is that all that keeps you alive? You having a body full of healthy parts and taking care of them, and with a boss brain to keep them all on the job? What do you think? Well, there are some things that you need to stay alive, and there are some things, just as important, that you need to feel alive. What are some of those things? How about your feelings? Have you ever felt so sad you could cry? Or so bored you could scream? Or so happy you could just bust? Or so mad that you could spit? Have you? Well, isn't it having feelings like these that make you feel alive? And what about that most important feeling of all? Love. This may sound strange, but in order to feel alive, you need people to love you, and you need people to love. Remember that. What else helps you feel alive? Using your senses to enjoy things. Do you enjoy looking at the moon and the stars at night? Do you like to hear the sound of rain on the roof, splashing in a puddle, smelling cookies baking, cuddling a baby kitten? Things like these make you feel alive, don't they? And isn't part of being alive doing things and making things? What do you like to do? Ride bikes? Go swimming? Go sledding, play cops and robbers, play with dolls and stuffed animals. Things like these are all fun, aren't they? It's also exciting to make things using your own ideas. Lisa likes to make things out of scrap materials. Here's a family that she made out of old worn bricks. Now look, here's the mother with a piece of fur for her hair. And here's the father. Look at him, he has a mussel shell for a mustache, pebbles for eyes. And here's the little girl. She has yellow yarn hair and a big, wide, smiling mouth made out of rickrack. There are lots of things around your house that you can make things out of too, right? Or maybe you like to make pictures. Lin Yi does. Here's a picture Lin Yi drew after she went to visit a lake for the first time. She used blue paper and brightly colored chalks to draw the buoys and the motorboats and the sailboats. I wonder if she had a chance to go out on one of these boats. Or maybe you like to make pictures with words. David Robinson wrote a poem about the earth. This is a poem, the kind of poem that doesn't rhyme. Why don't you read it with me, all right? We live on earth. Earth is a planet. Trees live on earth. Earth is our planet. It rains, it snows on earth. The sun shines on earth. We all like earth. Earth is nice. David's poem is nice too. Now suppose you wrote a poem or drew a picture or made a whatchamacallit out of stones. Yours would look different from all the ones we just saw. Why is that? Because no one can write a poem, tell a story, bake a cake, make a clay pot, draw a picture, just the same way you can. Being able to do things the way that only you can do them is really a great part of being alive. Now, is there anything else that makes you feel alive? Yes, what you're doing right now, learning new things. And you're learning new things all the time. And I hope that you enjoy learning as much as I enjoy teaching all about you.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
What this is, don't you? It's just an ordinary, ready-to-be-cooked, sunny-side-up breakfast egg. I had one this morning. Maybe you did, too. Are all eggs alike? Well, some of them are bigger. Goose eggs are. And an ostrich egg is. And some of them are smaller. Robin's eggs are. And so are the chickadees. but they're all pretty much alike inside. There. They all have a yolk, which is that yellow part right in the middle, with some sticky white stuff around it. Now, not all eggs are like this one. Some of them are different. Some of them have something special inside. They have something growing inside. Here's one that did. Well, what is this coming out of an egg? Some kind of an animal. What kind of animal do you think it is? Mm-hmm. Yes, some kind of a bird, isn't it, with very wet feathers. Just about enough strength left to wiggle his head at that point. He takes a few deep breaths, and then what? Ah, he spreads his wings. But he's still not out of the egg yet, is he? Ah, a few little peeps to let us know he's here. Oh, that's it. One more good push and he's out of the egg. Now, wasn't that exciting? We just saw a gosling hatch out of an egg. A gosling, you know, is a baby goose. And you saw how he got out. He pecked and wiggled and kicked and wriggled and fell flat on his face. And then he rested while his feathers dried. The gosling started as something very small inside the egg. And where did the egg come from? From the mother goose. It came from inside her body. First she laid it, and then she sat on it for many days, keeping it warm until the baby goose inside was ready to hatch out. All kinds of animals start as something very small. Cats, dogs, mice, elephants. It happens all the time. But do all animals start from eggs the mother sits on? Do you think this mother cat sat on a nest of eggs? Have you ever seen kittens hatching out of eggs? Oh, mother. Well, neither have I. So where do you suppose the kittens came from 6 weeks ago? I'll give you a clue. 6 weeks and one day ago, Mama was a very fat cat. Now, I guess you know where those kittens were. They came from inside her body, where they were kept warm and safe. And here they are today, 6 weeks old. They still look tiny and helpless, don't they? And they still need their mother for warmth and food and protection. Let's stop and think for a moment what we have discovered so far. Some animals hatch or are born outside their mother's body. And some animals grow into babies inside their mother's body. What about you? Did you hatch from an egg like a gosling? Or did you grow inside your mother's body like a kitten? Nod your head if you knew that human babies grow inside their mother's body. Ah, okay. Yes, before you were born, you grew for 9 months inside your mother's body. Not in her stomach, but in a hollow place called the uterus. In the beginning, you were a special cell. It was no bigger than a dot. Just about this size. Now, something this size doesn't look like much, does it? But that's the wonder of it all, that from one tiny cell came something as big and wonderful as you. Now, if we could look at that special cell under a microscope, this is what we would see. You can see the cell membrane around it and the nucleus in the center. After a day or two, this special cell divided and became two cells. And the two cells divided and became four cells, and so on. It kept on dividing this way until the clump of cells became a tiny, bumpy ball. And the ball was hollow and filled with water. It fastened itself to the inside of the uterus. It kept on growing more and more cells. About 4 weeks after it had started, the ball was about as big as a dime, except it wasn't round anymore. The ball had changed shape. It now looked something like a tadpole, with a head and a tail. There was water all around it. You grew curled up in this waterbed until the day you were born. When you had been growing for about 5 weeks, a tiny heart began to beat. Cells that would make arms and legs began to grow. Already, you see, your cells had different jobs to do. At the end of 2 months, you were still odd looking, but you did begin to look more like a baby. You had arms and hands and fingers, and legs and feet and toes. But you were still very small. You were only as big as your thumb. By the time you had been growing for 5 months, you had been moving around inside the uterus for some time. But now your mother could feel you moving your arms and legs. You were now about 10 inches long, just a little bigger than one of the kittens. But you still had a lot more growing to do. 2 months before you were born, you were all wrinkled like a little old lady or a little old man. You could open your eyes and close them. You could find your mouth and suck your thumb. You were beginning to grow eyebrows and lashes and hair on your head. All your organs, inside and out, had grown into the things they were supposed to be. But you weren't ready to be born yet. You still needed to wait and grow. But no living things can grow without taking in food and air and getting rid of waste. How were you able to eat and breathe and get rid of waste inside your mother? Well, you didn't breathe through your nose or eat through your mouth the way you do now, but there was a way. It has something to do with that funny place here in the middle of your tummy, your belly button. Before you were born, that was part of a tube that connected you to your mother. Do you see that tube all curled up in there with the baby? You got your food and oxygen and got rid of waste through that tube, which was connected to your mother's bloodstream. Whatever went into her body could be taken into yours. And so you went on eating and sleeping and moving and growing inside your mother. You were getting fatter and stronger all the time. And finally, after 9 months of growing from that one tiny cell, you were ready to come out into this exciting world. And what do you think was the first thing you did on that big day, your birthday? Yes, you gave a loud cry to let everyone know you had arrived and to take that first breath of air on your own. And probably the first person you met was the doctor. He did many things for you. He checked you all over very gently and carefully and listened to your heart to be sure that you were all right. When the doctor was through, there were many things a nurse did for you. To find out how big you were, she measured you. And then she put you on a scale to find out how much you weighed. She put a bracelet with your last name on it, on your leg, and another one on your wrist, so that everyone would know who you were. She also took your footprint with an ink pad for the same reason. Everyone was being very careful that you wouldn't be mixed up with the other babies when you went to the nursery. You needed lots of care in the nursery. A nurse washed you all over to make you shiny clean. And then she put on your first diaper and wrapped you in soft, warm clothing. Her finishing touch was to pretty you up by brushing your hair. Getting born is hard work, and you were ready for a rest now. So she put you down to sleep in a little crib. And there you were, a new little human being, all ready to start on your way to growing up. Meanwhile, everyone was so anxious to meet you, especially your mother and father. Your mother couldn't wait to take you in her arms and hold you. Your mother and father couldn't take their eyes off you. They already loved you because you were theirs. Your father couldn't wait to hold you either. They were so proud of you, they wanted to tell everyone about you. How big you were, how tiny you were, how hungry you were, how sleepy you were, how loud you cried. Oh, and of course, how beautiful you were. And they also wanted to tell everybody your name. They were looking forward to the day when they could take you home and show you off some more. Now, you know something about the beginning of a very important person. Who? You!
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
That bloom in the spring. Hi, I love spring. It's my favorite time of year. I like the pussy willows. I like the warm sunshine. I like the new green leaves on the tree. I like to hear the birds singing. And I love all these flowers that bloom on the plants in my garden, on the trees and the shrubs. I like all these things, but best of all, I like the animals. I'll bet you do too. This young chick, half down and half feathers, hatched from an egg just a few weeks ago, and look at her now, strutting around, pecking for food, eating and sleeping. She's getting stronger and bigger every day. Well, she's really on her way to becoming a full-grown hen who will one day lay eggs of her own. And look at this baby bunny. Isn't he cute? Oh, so soft and cuddly. Look at the long hind legs and the little puffed tail. know, when he was born, he was only about as long as a crayon. Now he's getting bigger every day. Won't be long before he's a big rabbit, maybe a father rabbit. I wonder, can you tell me, how are the chicken and the bunny and all other animals alike? Well, what's one way they're alike? What are they made of? Yes, cells, that's right. That's one way they're alike. They're all made of cells. But why will the chicken, the little chick, be a chicken and not a pigeon? And why will the bunny be a rabbit and not a cat? And why won't you be, like our friend here, a rabbit? These sound like silly questions, I know. But are they? Let's try to find out. Why aren't you a rabbit? Well, I suppose because a baby rabbit has to have a mama rabbit and a papa rabbit. And the mama rabbit herself has to have a mama rabbit and a papa rabbit. And the papa rabbit has to have a mama rabbit and a papa rabbit. And I could go on like that until I was out of breath and you had fallen asleep listening. But you weren't born a rabbit or a chicken. Instead, you're a human animal, like my three babies, Lisa, Emily, and Sarah. They're human because their father is human, and I am human too. And my husband's mother and father are human, and my mother and father are human, and so on. You know, people have known for a long time that living things make new living things of their own kind. Elephants make elephants, sparrows make sparrows, and people make people. Why is this? How can this be when all living things are made of cells? Is there some secret? Is there some secret that will explain all these things? Yes, there is. And the secret is in your cells. We're going to look at the same movie of a cell dividing that we looked at once before. This time, look at the dark gray threads inside the cell. You see them dividing and pulling apart. Those dark threads are very important because that's where the secrets are. The dark threads are made up of little tiny parts called genes. Genes are little packages of information. Your genes contain the information that decided what you would look like when you were born. When you look at a cell, remember our cell model? You see usually three main parts. There's the cell membrane that goes around the outside, and the watery, jelly-like living cytoplasm inside. And then here in the middle is the most important part of all, the nucleus. The dark threads that are made up of genes, those packages of information, are right here. You see them? In the nucleus. They contain the information that decided what you would be like when you were born. Now, what are some of the things that your genes decide for you? Well, first of all, they decide what kind of animal you're going to be, that you're going to be a human animal, and that you will have all the parts and the organs and the features that make you like other humans. This and other things, too, are decided for you right from the beginning, from your beginning, when you were just one cell. Nod your head, yes or no, if you know what a blueprint is. Ah, well, some of you do, and some of you don't. Well, a blueprint is a plan for building something. This is a blueprint of my place, as though you were looking down on it from above. This is the porch. This shows where the window seat is, and the divider that I like to sit on, and the door. And this is the room where I'm standing now. This is the wall with all the cupboards and shelves on it. Now, this part of the blueprint shows what the cupboards and shelves look like, the way we usually see them. It's the plan that the carpenter worked from. Now, what does a blueprint have to do with you and your genes? Well, your genes are a blueprint, too, for building you. They contain all the information you needed that decided what you would be like when you were born. And the surprising thing about it is that all that information was contained in that very first tiny special cell that you started from. There's a word that we call baby animals before they are hatched or born. The word is embryo. Let's hear you say it. Embryo. Okay. Well, right now, let's look at the embryos of three different animals as they grow, beginning from a clump of cells. Let's make it a game. See if you can guess what kind of animal each embryo is. Can you tell now? Okay, can you tell now? No, but the genes in each embryo have the information. Can you tell now? Still no. But isn't this interesting? Although those are embryos of three different animals, they all look very much alike. They're all head and tail and eyes. Now can you tell? Oh, I think if you look carefully, that if you look at the one on the right with a beak, you can tell it's an embryo chick or some kind of bird. And the one on the left with a snout and the curly tail is an embryo pig. And the one in the middle, yes, it's a human baby. And you know, it's only been growing for a very short time. So, the first thing your genes decide for you is what? What kind of animal you're going to be. Right. And your genes also decide whether you're going to be a boy or a girl. Where do your genes come from? From your parents. Half of them come from your mother, and half of them come from your father. The things that you get from your parents through your genes, we say you inherit. Inherit is a very useful word. Can you say it? Inherit. Oh, fine. Well, what are some of the things that you inherit from your parents through their genes? What are some of those other things that your genes decide for you? Well, color, for one thing. The genes decide how many grains of color you will have in your skin. You inherit your skin color from your parents. And they got theirs from their parents, who got theirs from their parents, who got theirs from their parents, who got theirs from their parents, and so on, all the way back to the first people on Earth. Nobody knows for sure just what color skins they had. And your genes also decide what color eyes you will have and what color your hair will be. Oh, and whether your hair will be curly or straight. What else do you inherit? Well, since half of your genes come from your mother and half of them from your father, maybe you look a little bit like each of them. And maybe you look more like one than the other. My daughter Emily has eyes that are shaped like and a chin that is shaped like her father's. Do you see how round his chin is? But Lisa is much different. She has a longer, thinner face and a turned-up nose. And where do you think she got those, I wonder? That's right, from me. And you know what? The genes in your body cells will decide what your children will be like if you have children of your own someday. Well, we've been talking a lot about the things that you inherit. Are there some things you don't inherit? Are there some things that your genes don't decide for you? Let's think about that. Did your genes decide what your name would be? Did your genes decide what language you would learn as a baby? Did they decide what you would wear on the first day of school? Ah, of course not. Your parents gave you your name. And you spoke the language you heard spoken as a baby. And you, and someone at home, decided what you would wear on the first day of school. Oh, and here's another question. Why will you be spending so many years of your life in school? Isn't it because there are so many things that you don't inherit? Things that you need to learn and want to learn? And as you grow older, there are more and more things that you can choose to learn and choose to do. You can choose whether you're going to take good care of yourself so that you'll grow up healthy and look and feel your best. And you can choose whether you're going to be kind and considerate of other people's feelings. Everybody has feelings, don't they? And you can choose what your hobbies will be and what you will study. You can choose what you will be when you grow up. And what will you be? Who knows the answer to that secret? It's nobody else but you.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Look at pictures of yourself when you were a baby. Nod your head if you do. My children do too. In fact, they've almost worn the cover off of this album with baby pictures. I like to look at them too. It reminds me of all the cute things they said and did when they were little. Baby pictures also make you think about the things that you couldn't do when you were a baby that you can do now. If you stop and think about it, you've learned to do a lot of really very important and grown-up things in those few years since you were a baby. What sort of things? Well, here's one. It rhymes with walk. There, you just did it. Talk, that's right. You talk like grown-ups do. What else? Raise your hand and pretend you have a pencil. Now, if you can, write your name. Just your first name will do. You write yours and I'll write mine, okay? Did you do it? Did you write your name? Good. Can you write other words too? Can you write a sentence? Oh, that's just terrific. And what's that other important thing, like writing, that you're learning to do in school? I'll bet everyone here can do it and is getting better at it every day. Let's see if you can read this. Dogs say, wow. And cows say moo. But baby only says ah-goo. Not very exciting poetry, but isn't it exciting that you can read? Have you always been able to read and write? You couldn't read and write when you were first born, could you? Why, You couldn't even see. You were pretty helpless then. When you were first born, you couldn't walk, talk, sit up, or roll over. You couldn't even hold your head up. Someone had to feed you, change your diapers, give you a bath, and do just about everything for you. Was there anything that you could do? Yes, there was one thing you could do very, very well. You could let people know that you were around. You could cry.
Look at that.
Now that is an unhappy baby. I wonder what's the matter.
Come here, try this plug. Try this plug.
Nope. He's really angry. Look how red his face is.
Okay.
He's unhappy all over. Is that what you did to your mother? Yes, you did. You did that every time you wanted to let them know something was wrong. But you weren't that helpless all the time. You were growing. Not only were you growing by inches and pounds, you were growing by using your brain. By the time you were 8 months old, you could sit up and were beginning to get around. Like Emma Kate. Let's watch Emma Kate and see what she does. What can she do with her hands? She can pick up her toy, hold it, shake it, and throw it around too. Babies love to do that, don't they? Emma Kate creeps on hands and knees when she wants to go someplace. She can struggle, and she can pull herself up and stand. Watch.
Up here. Up here. It's your turn.
But she's a little wobbly still. See? There she goes. Don't worry, you put ridiculous things in your mouth, too. But you, of course, you don't do that anymore either, do you? Hey, did you ever stop to think how many things you can do now that you couldn't do when you were a baby? You can walk and talk and read and write. Sure, so many things. Let's just look in on someone your age and see what he does. That is, if we can wake him up.
Wake up! There's lots to do today. Wait a minute. You don't have to get dressed that fast. Do all of you dress as fast as that? Really? Whew. Now that he's big enough, Davy gets his own breakfast, and his sister Becky's. Maybe when you get yours, you have some of the same problems. Those cabinets are made for people a little taller. The cereal box is easy enough to handle. It's big, but not heavy. Don't forget to shut the door, Davy. It's a good thing that bottle isn't any bigger. Only a little spill, and easy enough to take care of.
Pick it up. Okay, just keep it.
At Becky's age, you didn't worry about using a spoon all the time either. But you know better now. And so does Davy. Saturdays are too good to spend inside, aren't they? Davy agrees with you, and he's off to the barn alone to get his pony, Beauty.
Come on, let's go.
She's feeling ready for a ride. But first, Davy has to brush her down. Even though he's only 7, like a good horseman, Davy takes good care of his horse. He brushes Beauty every day, and nobody has to remind him.
Can you help me, please?
Do you ask for help when you need it? Davy knows when he needs Walter's help. The saddle is still a little too heavy, but like all of you, Davy is growing up fast, and he'll soon be able to handle it by himself.
You can help me, right? I'm gonna tie the knot now, Davy, right? You're gonna put it in through there, out there. You have to pull it way down there.
Yeah, but put it in there.
Right through there.
So now,
hold that there.
David, before you go riding, would you come in and watch Rebecca for a few minutes?
Yeah.
Now, you gotta put your thumb in her mouth so she'll open her mouth. And you can put the bit through, like that. And this goes over the right ear first, and then the left ear. Then these gotta go up underneath their temples. And this has gotta be straight right here. Pull this piece through here, and this goes right under there. Same this side. All right, I'll sit.
Lucky, you want to read a book?
Having a brother or sister is fun. And if they're younger, you can help your mother by watching them when she's busy. There are lots of things you can do to keep them out of trouble. After all, you're not a baby anymore.
Goodbye, Moon. Good morning, Sun. Good morning, sunflowers. Everyone. Good morning, baby. Hush, hush, hush. Good morning, milk. Good morning, mush. Baby. Good morning. Good morning. It's time to play. Wanna play?
Do you enjoy playing alone sometimes? Davy has friends to play with, but he likes to go off by himself, too. He's happy just to be riding Beauty through the woods to the pond. And like all of you, Davy has some favorite games to play when he's by himself. I wonder what it's going to be today. Maybe it's going to be a castle. What would you build in the sand? Can you do all the things Davy can? Get dressed by yourself? Make your own breakfast? Look after younger children in the family? Take care of your pets? Help your mother? And can you look after yourself when you go out alone to play?
You can do many grown-up things, can't you? And just think of how many things you'll be able to do when you have grown a little more. Now, I want you to think hard of something that you're proud of that you have learned to do this year. Have you learned to tie your shoes, to swim, to ski, to row a boat, to ride a bike, to ride a horse? Just for fun, why don't you make a picture of yourself doing this new thing? Your picture can have a title. Why don't you call it Look at Me Now?
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Big eyes on this one, and she's grinning so hard she looks like she's going to split from ear to ear.
Hey, what you doing?
Hi, Susie Snippet.
Hi.
Well, we're looking at baby pictures.
Really? Oh, what a silly thing to do. What are you doing that for?
Oh, because babies are cute and lovable, and sometimes they make the funniest faces.
Yeah. I don't like to look at them. They're all alike. Do you know what? They yell a lot. Wah! Wah! All alike. And they leak at both ends. All alike. They all look alike. And I think it's silly to waste time looking at them. Ugh, not looking.
Oh, now, Susie Snippet. Babies are not all alike, and they certainly don't all look alike.
Yeah.
Now, look at these. Tell me what you think.
Well, they don't exactly look alike, but that's because one of them's a black baby and one isn't. But you show me two babies of the same race, and I bet they'll look alike.
Oh, okay. Let's see. All right, what about these?
Let me see. Oh, well, I saw. I guess they don't look quite alike, I guess.
And what about these?
Okay. Maybe you're right. Hey, wait just a minute. If you're so smart, what about them? I got you this time. Yeah, you mean they didn't look alike as babies? Then how come they're the same now?
Well, Susie, sure, they looked alike as babies, and they look alike now. But you're making a mistake calling them the same. You're not the same, are you?
No way.
Oh, phooey. Phooey, phooey, phooey. All babies don't look alike. You're mixing me all up. Some kids look alike, but they're not alike. And What is this? I give up. I'm leaving. So there.
Okay. Let's turn around and sit down. Greg and Gary are identical twins. Identical means looking alike. And you two do look alike. In fact, you know what? I have trouble remembering which is which.
Gregory.
You're Gregory.
Gary.
And you're Gary. Well, I'm very glad that you could be here today because I've always wanted to meet a pair of identical twins. Tell me, what's it like? Is it fun being twins?
Yes.
Do you think it's fun?
Yes.
It's fun. You look alike and you sound alike to me, too. Do most people have trouble telling which is which?
Yes, yes.
Who has trouble?
Our nana sometimes.
Your nana, your grandmother? What does she do? Does she call you by the wrong name?
Yeah.
And you too?
Yeah.
Oh. So you mix up your grandmother. How about your mother? How does she know which is which?
Sometimes she gets mixed up.
Oh, even your mother gets mixed up?
Yeah, sometimes.
Well, I can see why. They look alike, they sound alike, they dress alike. But listen, you know, I told Susie Snippet that you weren't the same. So, am I right? Can you help me? Can you think of any way that you're different?
I know, yeah.
Okay, what?
Because I'm a little bigger.
If one's a little taller and one's a little shorter, that's one good way that I can tell that you're different. I'm interested in other things, too. What about your friends? I know you're good friends, but who's your best friend?
Sean.
Sean is your best friend?
Manny.
And Manny is your best friend, so you have different friends. Do you like the same foods? What do you like to eat?
Chicken.
Chicken? What do you like?
Chicken and
Gary.
Chicken, potatoes.
Chicken and potatoes.
And chicken, potatoes with gravy.
Gravy? And tell me what you like.
French fries. And the same thing.
You like the same thing, but you also like French fries, right?
Yeah,
well, this is very interesting. You have different friends, you like different foods, you like to do different things. Well, I think we're keeping you here too long. You probably want to get down to the playground and play some baseball, kickball maybe? Yeah, okay. Well, then let's let you be on your way. I don't want to keep you any longer, okay? Thanks for coming. And have fun. There's the door right over there. Have fun. Goodbye. Wasn't that interesting, meeting and talking with some real live identical twins? Suppose all the boys in your class were identical twins. Suppose all the girls in your class were identical twins, too. Or even worse, suppose all the boys looked alike and suppose all the girls looked exactly alike. What then? Wouldn't that be weird? You might even have to wear a name tag around your neck so that everyone would know who you were. Do you think there's any country or just any place in the world where everyone looks exactly like everyone else? You're right. There's no place like that. Thank goodness for that. Everyone has a different face. And what makes faces different? Well, for one thing, color of face. Some faces are light brown, and some faces are dark brown, and some are just a shade in between, depending on the number of grains of pigment in the skin, grains of color. And some faces are freckled. But then you already knew that, didn't you? What else makes faces different? I'll give you a hint. Where is the... yes. Noses, right. Now, not all noses are as big as this one, but they're all different, and large or small, they're all useful for one thing, and what's that? Smelling, right. Okay, what else is different? Some hair is curly, like this. Is your hair curly? Oh, And some hair is straight, like mine, but I like to put a few curls in it. But straight or curly, hair comes in lots of different colors. Hey, I wonder, what would I look like as a redhead, I wonder? Well, now you know. Now, it's not just hair. Let's not forget other things make faces different. What about eyes, mouths, yes, ears, chins, foreheads, right, eyelids? And those are just some of the things that make people look different. Are there others? Yes, what about size and shape? Are you exactly the same height as all the other children in your class? Maybe you're the tallest. Maybe you're the shortest. Or maybe you're taller than some and shorter than others. And the same thing is true of shape, too, isn't it? Why is it that you are different in size and shape and face and coloring than anyone else in your class? Let's see if you remember. It's because you began from a different set of genes way back when you were just one special cell. And do you remember I said that half of those genes came from your father and half of them came from your mother? Well, each new baby is a new beginning with a new set of genes. Your brothers and your sisters began from a different set of genes, even though they have the same mother and the same father that you do. You and your brothers and sisters may look something alike. Maybe you have big eyes and dark curly hair, but you don't look exactly like anyone else in your family, unless, of course, like Greg and Gary, you're an identical twin. What makes identical twins identical? Ah, that's a good question. In the beginning, when instead of one special cell growing into one baby, the one special cell divides and separates into two cells, and those two cells grow into two babies. And when this happens, both of those babies inherit from their parents the same set of what? Genes, right. Now, so far, we've been talking about differences that are inherited from your parents through genes. But what about differences that are not inherited? How do they happen and where do they come from? I mean, even Greg and Gary, who are identical twins, like different things and they dislike different things. How is this? Well, each one of you has to experience things all by yourself as you go along from the time you were born. Now, do you think that you have the same experiences as every other child? Do you think that all children everywhere learn the same things as they grow up? What about children who live in two different parts of the world? Do you think that Assad, who lives in the desert with his sheep-herding family, has the same experiences as Jimmy Ranook, who has to learn to hunt seal through a hole in the ice and to drive a dog team? What about children who live just a few miles apart? Do you think that Roger, who lives in a brick apartment house with his mother and father and baby brother and his dog, has the same experiences as Mark, who lives in this house with his mother, his grandmother, his three sisters, and his cat? You're right. They know different things and they like different things. They have different friends and activities. Experience makes a big difference. Whether it's something that happens to you or whether it's something that you choose to do, every little tiny experience you have becomes part of the many experiences that make your whole life. And no two people can have the exact same set of experiences, not even identical twins. And that's why, of all the boys and girls in the world, there are no two alike. And that's what makes people interesting, being different. You're different in very special ways from every other human being. No one else looks and acts and thinks exactly like you. As my daughter Lisa once said, I am the only me, and you are the only you. Aren't you glad you're you? I am, and I'm glad I'm me.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
My nose is all itchy and twitchy. And my throat is scratchy. I feel chilly all over. I think I must be getting a bug.
Bug? Bug? Humbug. You're not getting any bug, my dear. You're getting me. Iris the virus.
Iris the virus? Uh-oh. I've heard about you.
Nothing good, I hope.
Well, as a matter of fact, no. Only horrid things.
Oh, good. That's fine. I wouldn't want you and the children to think that I was some sort of goody-goody, because I positively am not. And I don't want anybody to call me a bug. Call me a germ if you wish, or a microbe, or a virus. But I am not a creepy, crawly, ugly old bug. I'm more interesting and smaller, too.
And smaller, too? Pardon me, but you don't exactly look tiny to me.
Well, I went and got myself magnified today. That's why you can see me. I'm 200,000 times bigger than I really am. Why, if I were a kitten instead of a virus, I'd be as big as 10 tigers.
Good grief! And what are you doing here?
My mission is to bring you and the dear children whom I love a disease.
A disease? Oh, what disease?
One of the more common garden variety types, unfortunately. You people call it a cold. I myself would prefer to bring you a more exciting disease like chicken pox or mumps, but...
Oh, what a dreadful mission.
Oh, depends on your viewpoint. My friends and I find it most stimulating work. Why, we spread hundreds of diseases to people, plants, and animals all over the world.
Oh? How?
We do our work quietly and discreetly. You neither see us nor hear us arrive. Why, we are already at work in the cells of your body before you know you are sick. Do you remember that sore throat you felt last night?
Oh, how could I forget it?
Oh, my dear, a virus was already in residence in you before you felt that sore throat.
How did it get in?
Oh, through some orifice in your head. Your mouth or nose, I presume. My friends and I can always find a way.
Your friends?
You mean there are others like you?
Oh, I happen to have some pictures right here. Oh, there's Minnie Mumps. She's not quite the success she used to be. But at the top of her career, she made a lot of children unhappy. Oh, and there's Maurice Measles. I wonder how many of you dear children have had the measles. Raise your hands if you have. Oh, good, I'm delighted. Hands down. Let's see now. Oh, and here's Charlie Chickenpox. He's a dashing, spotty, dotty kind of fellow, isn't he? Oh, and then there's that favorite of mine, Flossie Flew. And many others, too numerous to mention. My affectionate friends and I are everywhere. Just everywhere.
How do they get everywhere?
Oh, elementary, my dear. I'll just borrow the dirty tissue, please.
Oh, hey, stop it. Cut it out. Here.
There. That's one way germs get scattered around by careless people.
Iris, the virus, give me that dirty tissue right now.
Too late, my dear, too late. By that simple gesture, I may have scattered millions of germs around this room. Why, they've probably landed on everything.
Oh, no. Oh, dear.
You may take that as just one suggestion.
One suggestion? One suggestion for what?
On how to share your cold germs with others. The cold germs I've so generously given you. I'd like you to share them with the dear children.
What? Me? Share my cold, my virus with the children? Ah, not on purpose, I won't. Never. No way. Not in a million years.
But, my dear, how can you help it?
I don't know, but I'm thinking of a way.
Uh-oh. She's too smart. She knows too much about too many things. She could be dangerous. My dear, I must say that you are steadfast in the line of duty.
Oh.
For that, I personally want to reward you with this splendid lollipop.
Oh. Iris? Where did you get this lollipop?
Well,
Iris? This lollipop's been used.
Used? I should say not. At least, not very much. It's only been licked a few times by two small boys and a big shaggy dog. But you could hardly call that used, could you?
Iris, that's so sweet of you. But I wouldn't dream of taking your lollipop. You have it. Ooh, I wouldn't touch that secondhand lollipop of hers for anything. Yuck. What a scheming character that Iris the virus is. Trying to make me believe that it's good to share a cold. You can't trust her. But she was telling the truth when she said, germs are everywhere. They are. They're all over your hands, your desks, your pencils, everything you touch. Then why aren't you sick all the time? That's a good question. Why aren't you? Why aren't you all sick at home in bed this very minute? Well, it's because you have some good guys inside you to fight off the bad guys like Iris and her friends. Your good guys are called antibodies. Antibodies. That's a funny word, isn't it? Anyway, your antibodies are in your blood. They get rid of the bad guys by surrounding the germs that would make you sick and killing them. Where did the antibodies come from? How did they get inside your body? As a matter of fact, everyone is born with some antibodies in their blood. But if your body needs more, it can make more to fight off real tough, nasty germs. If you get the chickenpox virus, your body makes chickenpox antibodies to fight off the chickenpox germs. And the wonderful part is, once you have a virus disease like the chickenpox, you never have it again. The antibodies your body made stay with you all your life. That's true for measles, mumps, whooping cough,
Oh, and many other virus diseases.
Did I hear my name?
Oh. Does your body have other good guys to help keep you well? Yes, it does. Your skin is one of them. Your skin is like the walls and windows of a house. It keeps out dirt and germs, just like the walls and windows of a house keep the dust and bugs out.
Your skin is like the walls of a house. You sound as if you had holes in your head.
Yes, I do. Everybody does. You do, too. Can you find the holes in your head? Point them out to me. That's right. Your mouth, your nose, your ears, your eyes. And they're all places that germs can enter easily. What was I saying? Oh, yes. But on the inside of your nose and your mouth, you've got sticky stuff. And that sticky stuff usually traps the germs that get inside and get rid of them before they can start growing inside you. And what about your eyes? Your eyes have got tear fluid in them, and they usually trap and kill and wash away any germs that get in them.
Like I said, big deal.
Well, it is a big deal. You have your own private army of germ killers to deal with things like iris.
We don't have to talk about that. Children, don't listen to a word she says.
But sometimes the good guys in your body just aren't strong enough to help you get rid of the bad guys like Iris. Then your doctor helps you out. He either gives you some medicine or, for germs that you really can't get rid of, he uses... this!
Oh, my!
Oh. Oh. There! I finally got rid of Iris the virus. Whew. Oh, I hope you're not that frightened of a needle. A needle hurts Iris much more than it hurts you. A needle hurts, but the hurt lasts only for a second. Being sick in bed lasts for days. Sometimes a shot is the only way your doctor can get enough antibodies in you to keep you from getting sick. There are vaccines. That's the liquid stuff inside the needle for a great many diseases. That's why almost no one has measles or mumps or whooping cough anymore. Minnie Mumps, in fact, claims that she's unemployed. Oh, excuse me. Oh, but you know what? There's no vaccine for the common cold yet. So does that mean that I'm going to have to go on sniffling and snuffling and blowing my nose for 3 or 4 days? Afraid so. But isn't there something I could do to keep from getting a cold in the first place? Is there something you could do? Yes, I think there is. Everybody stand up. Okay. Put your hand over your mouth like this. And repeat after me. I do solemnly swear, you say it, that I will remember to wash my hands before I eat. To not put my fingers in my mouth. To never eat food other people have been eating. To cover my mouth when I cough or sneeze. To stay away from people who have sneezles, wheezles, or measles. And to help other people keep well. Excellent. Thank you. Okay, we can all sit down and relax now. See you. See you.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Out. Beware of dog. Danger. No swimming. Stop. Okay, I will. What's this all about? I think it's about safety. Yours, and of course mine too. Why do we need signs? Who can tell me? As warnings, right. You are old enough now to go out of the house on your own. And that means that you're old enough to watch out for your own safety. Signs can help you remember the things you need to remember to stay safe. You would think everyone knew that, wouldn't you? But I once knew someone who didn't. That was Dora Dingbat. You just won't believe what I'm going to tell you. How one little dingbat all by herself could get into so much trouble. Dora's day started off just fine. In fact, it was so beautiful that she decided to get dressed and go for a walk. Forgot something? Let's hope not. Oh dear, I was right. Dora forgot to tie her shoes, and untied laces can trip you up. Day, and there must be something to do. That is a cute dog, isn't it, Dora?
But that sign is there for a reason. Was a mistake, but Dora is likely to make a bigger one if she doesn't watch where she is going. Was lucky. She could have been badly hurt. A pond. And that sounds like a frog. Don't you think she would have learned by now? Careful, Dora. Luckily, the pond was not very deep, but it was wet. Suddenly, she heard a voice. Kid. A young man held out his hand and pulled her up. Come with me, he said. I will take you home and I will give you candy. That sounded swell to Dora Dingbat. He had a shiny red motorcycle. She jumped onto his motorcycle, completely forgetting her mother had told her a million times never to ride with strangers. Dumb Dora Dingbat. Whee! This was fun! But suddenly, Dora realized they were not headed for her house at all. Dora didn't like this, and she began to worry. Where was he taking her? Who knows? She tried to tell him where her house was, but he paid no attention. What could she do? At the next red light, she jumped off. She ran and ran and ran. What was that? Oh no, it's a train. Watch out, Dora. Watch out. Was a close call. Dora decided right then and there that the next day she would stay home. Wasn't that a funny story? But the things that happened to Dora weren't really funny at all. Any of them could have landed her in the hospital or worse.
It really was a sad story in a way, because most of the bad things that happened to Dora happened because she didn't watch out. She didn't even use the safety signs to help her. But you and I and Dora don't have to leave home in order to get into trouble. You know that. There are plenty of places right inside your own home where you can get into trouble if you don't watch out. For example, electrical outlets can cause trouble for people who poke their fingers into them. The electricity that comes into this little box can toast a piece of bread or light up a whole room. It can give you a nasty shock. You are old enough to leave electrical outlets and all the other electric things alone. And you also want to keep your younger brothers and sisters who don't know any better away from them. And then there's the medicine chest. Medicines and pills are fine when the doctor orders them, but they are not candy, even if they do look pretty and they do taste good. They're a no-no. Of course, you know enough not to swallow anything marked poison or with this on it. But not all things that can be poisonous are marked poison. There is no poison label and no skull and crossbones on a bottle of aspirin. And too many aspirin taken all at the same time can kill you. Playing with matches and turning on the stove are other no-nos. I don't have to tell you why, do I? No, I didn't think so. And probably you know enough to be careful when you're using scissors and knives. They're not toys, you know. I worry about your eyes anytime you have a sharp pointed object in your hand. And then there are some things that are so dangerous, I hate to think about them. Here's one of them. This doesn't look very dangerous, does it? But if you were to put a plastic bag over your head, when you breathe in, the thin plastic sticks to your mouth. You get frightened. You breathe in harder, and the deeper you breathe, the tighter the plastic sticks. And you cannot breathe at all. Now, there's something else I want to show you. Ah! Oh! Oh, who put those there? That's not very smart, is it? Of course, there are toys in your house, too. But this is definitely not the place to leave them. Leaving toys in doorways and on stairs can cause somebody a bad fall. They might be badly hurt. But I started to show you something else. Old refrigerators may look like fun to play around, but they are very dangerous. Never, never hide yourself or close some other child up inside an old refrigerator. Let me show you why. See? Here's the handle on the outside of the door that opens and closes it. But there is no handle on the inside. The danger is that once you are inside and you close the door, there is no handle to open it again. You are trapped. And there isn't enough air in an old refrigerator, or any refrigerator, for you to continue breathing for very long. And as you know, we all must breathe in order to, what? Stay alive, right? So, watch out. Don't be a dingbat. Thank you.
All About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
A child's world is not like our world. Each day is a new life. Each moment is met with an open mind. And even the 56th time of doing something is just as fun as the first. One day they'll look back and realize this was innocence. But by then it will be long past. So while they're still young, while the slate is still clean, doesn't it make sense to fill it with the brightest pictures and the nicest thoughts? It's what they'll always find on the children's programs of public television. For as long as they've been watching us, we've been watching over them.
Look around and you'll see the future. In the hands of those who are just starting to explore. In the eyes of those just beginning to wonder. Some will take dreams we've yet to have and make them come true. Others will answer questions we haven't begun to ask. Of course, we have no way of finding the next Edison or the next Ellington, Austin, or Van Gogh. Not until they've discovered their own special talent, their own unique voice. So we do our best. And one of the things we do is give them a place where they can find that gift for themselves with the children's programming of public television. Perhaps the finest minds in history are here now. Where they go tomorrow is entirely up to us.
Yes, I can see by the early light the peril of the night is gone, and far across the distant range I see the road to
there are probably as many ways of looking at America as there are people who live here. And while someone else's views might seem too rational or too emotional,